Hi everyone, we're just going to wait for Sumaya to join us. Today we're going to be talking about how to use fitness to beat PMS. It's a question we get a lot from you girls about, you know, what exercises should I do during my period? I have cramps, what can I do to alleviate them? And so today hopefully we'll get you some solutions straight from an expert, Sumaya Dalmia. So we're just going to wait for her to come. Hi Sumaya, how are you?
Hi, how are you? Very well.
How is lockdown treating you?
Not bad. Same as it's treating everyone. Little relaxing, little anxious. But now that it's become a little easier, I think it's nice to actually try and go back into the real world and actually recognize that you don't want to go back.
I agree with you. Now that things feel alien, you know.
It really does.
I'm really excited to have you here. We get so
many questions
from our community about PMS and should I exercise when I'm on my period? Should I not? What do I do for cramps?
Right.
And I think it's such a personal question, you know. For one girl, she finds it easy to say workout, but for somebody else, the pain is too much and you can't. And I don't think there's one rule here, you know. But could you talk a little bit about that? And if you don't mind sharing what you personally have experienced yourself.
So, you know, a woman's menstrual cycle, which basically if we discuss it over, like if we just, for example, say that each woman is so different and so unique, their hormonal shift is so unique. But scientifically, we can definitely say that a menstrual cycle, I mean, an entire woman's menstrual cycle can be divided into four phases. So it spans over 4 weeks. And if you really understand what happens within those 4 weeks, it can actually really help you get in tune with your body and really start understanding how a body behaves. So personally, for you, it'll be slightly different. For me, it'll be slightly different. But generic rules are almost the same. So I think the first thing to start here by, you know, for all the audience, you know, you and I might feel that it's so obvious to know how a period cycle should be. But a lot of women really don't know the four, you know, how you divide them into four.
I feel like your period days are the most visible, the most physical days, right? But there's not much that we talk about outside of those 4 or 5 days.
And the outside, honestly, is the most important to understand because that's your kind of window. So just for everyone, you know, so the period cycle is actually divided into 4 phases. So the first phase starts from the day one of your period. So the day you start bleeding is the day one of your period and goes up to anywhere. It's called the bleeding phase, right? So from anywhere between 1 to 7 days. For some women, it's 3 days. For some women, it's 5. For some, it's 7. Anything beyond 7 should be, you know, if it's regular beyond 7, then of course it should be noted to a physician or an obstetrician or a gynecologist so that they can understand why it's longer than that. But anywhere between 1 to 7, 2 days minimum is normal. From there, if you go on to the second phase, which is actually the follicular phase, which say will be anywhere between 5 days to day 14. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's the day. So in the menstrual cycle, your bleeding days, your estrogen and progesterone, the most important hormones for a woman, are actually at its lowest, which is why you feel so exhausted. You get tired during your period. For most women, the PMS can be really bad because how sensitive you are to the dip of estrogen and progesterone depends on you personally, right? But you'll also notice the moment you finish your period, up to the mid-cycle of your period, so say 15th day of the period, automatically you start gaining some form of energy. Right. Sorry, my earphones have fallen off. One second. So you can't kind of explain what the energy is, but there's definite energy. You'll see your muscle tone is better. You're feeling leaner, you're feeling more energetic, right? So that's 14. Then comes your ovulation phase, which is when you feel the most energetic because you will feel all of a sudden some women actually their skin changes. You can see because the estrogen is at its highest at that point.
Some glow as well.
There's some glow. There are no pimples. There's no that occasional breakout. You're glowing. You know, you'll feel like super supremely energetic. Your sexual drive is at its peak, which is why they say this is the period to get pregnant, right? So it's the best phase. So which is a 2.5 week, 3.5 week mark. And then comes the really challenging phase, which is a luteal phase, which is just a week before your period, when your estrogen and progesterone and everything starts like dipping. And that dip is actually worse than the period itself. Right?
I agree. Because so, we basically get 2 good weeks a month.
Exactly. I mean, you know, when you scientifically read articles on it, you will say, maybe I just really get 2 good weeks a month. What nonsense. But that's the reason why, if you understand it, you won't get pulled down by it.
I agree.
And when you're aware of it, it's not like, you know, a lot of times you'll feel that, why am I feeling low? Why am I feeling low? I can't explain. But if you actually look down at your period clock, you'll say, it's my, you know, I've started my luteal phase, which is my last PMS phase, and which is why I'm feeling so shitty.
Why it's so important to track your period as well.
I think that is the most, I was coming to that. The most important thing to do is to track your period. There's so many apps for your period trackers. I love your period tracker app. I by the way, I've been, before we decided to do this live, actually, I've been a consumer of your product for the last 1 year, by the way.
Oh, how nice. Oh,
yeah, so because glad. I love the packaging, and I have a 13-year-old daughter who might just go into a period
soon.
You have
a 13-year-old daughter?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, and I love the packaging, and I love the fact that your napkins are so soft and so thin.
That's so sweet of you to say. Thank you.
I actually, on the fact that you can order, I know we're digressing from the topic, but I know you can order them in different sizes depending on your flow. So I love the fact that you can customize your pack. So I've actually ordered stuff for her to keep as, imagine yours is going to be the first exposure to sanitary napkin that she's ever going to have.
Oh, that's so nice to know. Honestly, that's made my day.
Your product is so gentle on the skin, which is the most important for active girls, right? It needs to be gentle and so that you have no rashes. Yeah. And no rubbing. But anyway,
I'd love to come. We can talk offline because I'd really love to know her experience when she starts.
I will. For sure.
Yeah.
And so now coming back to that topic. Let's go back. So that's how your four phases are divided. So it's bleeding, follicular phase, your ovulation phase. So the follicular and ovulation phase is that week two, week three mark where you're feeling your greatest, and then all of a sudden, 1 week before your period, you start dipping. Once you understand this cycle, it's actually very easy because estrogen as a hormone is an hormone which really affects a lot of women in different ways, right? So when your estrogen is high, you'll feel energetic, and people are so sensitive to estrogen. So even though my progesterone and estrogen ka jo level, I know it's a bit science, but it's nice to understand. Even though mine is higher, so it's in the normal range, but it might not be high enough for me. Right. So the moment you cross your 35s, you know, gynecologists start looking at your mid-cycle hormone health. Because if you go and say, I'm feeling tired and I'm feeling fatigue and I'm not being able to lose weight and I have unexplained water retention, they might tell you, okay, test yourself mid-cycle of your hormone health. Which is when they're trying to see that in your peak hormone health, how estrogen dominant are you? Because you should be, right? That's how you're going to ovulate. And the moment your estrogen dominance starts going down is when you actually start realizing, okay, now I need to eat foods which support estrogen, you know, help me with estrogen. I need to look at my hormone health. I need to eat less sugar foods, et cetera, et cetera.
So
coming back to the original question, should you exercise or not?
Yeah.
So if you scientifically go with the cycle, the four phases that I've explained to you, let's go by phase one, which is when you're actually bleeding. When you're actually bleeding, actually after the second day, things start easing out. So day one, for most people, day one or day two is when they actually heavily bleed. And internally, the body is giving you signals that you don't want to exercise, right? Because the bleeding is heavy, it's uncomfortable, et cetera, et cetera. At that point, if you are comfortable, a gentle walk, actually, which could be like a 2 kilometer walk, but not a brisk exercise walk, but movement. Any kind of movement will actually help you feel better. Yeah, just kind of any activity will help you feel better, but definitely not jumping, you know, nothing, not kickboxing. I mean, that stuff is going to make you feel really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So I always, you know, like even in my gyms, I always ask women, you know, when you're PMSing, tell your trainer, because the trainers are now, we've educated our trainers to understand, you know, they might design a workout and that's not the workout that needs to be done. So day one and day two are the only days where you might feel it's a personal choice whether you want to or you don't. I actually feel better when I exercise. So I don't do a HIIT. Yeah. So I don't do an HIIT kind of workout, but I'll definitely go for a brisk walk or I'll lie down and do some mat work. But I feel like I've achieved something. So I feel better, you know, the
For
hormones,
me,
the endorphins.
for me, if I don't have some movement and it's literally like a 20-minute
Yeah.
thing, I end up feeling more lethargic and worse than I did
Exactly.
before.
Exactly. From day three onwards, when your period flow starts going a little lesser, you automatically have this new gained energy. Your stomach starts feeling flatter because that's where you gain your energy, even though, so, you know, because when you're bloated and when you're, she's also suppressing pressure around that area, that you'll automatically see that, oh, I had a six pack, where is it gone? You know, why am I looking like the way it's looking? And that's for all athletes as well, right? So once that starts clearing out, you do end up feeling better. You feel firstly lighter, and the feeling of lightness is what gives you the regained energy. And that's when you start picking up the pace. But by day, so you can continue to your walk, you can take a longer mat work session, or you can go for a, you know, you can do start doing a little bit of weight training, because weight training also doesn't make you jump, etc. The moment you go into your follicular phase, which is say day 7 onwards, to day 20, okay, you ovulate on day 15, but say to day 15, you'll see your energy levels really start to rise. You feel better and better. Your skin starts clearing out. If you've got an occasional zit, it'll start clearing out. You'll feel energetic. So the second week from the day of your first period is a good time to actually do functional workouts, because you have so much regained energy, because your estrogen and progesterone are rising, that you feel energetic. So when you go in to do an HIIT workout, or if you go in to do a full body workout, you start noticing you feel better. Your recovery is better. You're feeling, you can actually, this is a good time to actually break a plateau. You know, like sometimes we all get stuck and we get stuck into
Or
a
try
plateau and you want
something
to
new.
increase. Yeah, try something new, increase in exercise. So this is a really good time to try something new, because your body will recover better during this time. Up until your ovulation period, which is roughly about day 15 to 16, at day 15, you are at your personal best. So if you want to box and kick and punch, that is the time to do it. That week
Great
of the week 15,
excuse to do these things
yeah,
also.
this is the best time to do it, because you'll really recover well. You have a lot of energy. You are less prone to injuries, because I won't get into the science of it, but there's a big correlation between progesterone and injuries. So when your progesterone and estrogen, they are at its good peak levels, you are lesser prone to injuries. So this is a really good time to pick up the pace with your activities, you know? And then comes your PMS phase, which is your luteal phase. Everything starts crashing. And when it starts crashing, and for some women it could be 7 days PMS, some women it can be 3 to 5 days. But the women who have longer PMS days, more than 10 days, then again, that needs intervention of a gynecologist, because it shouldn't be happening. Because that shows you that in your mid-cycle, your hormone health is not great. Because if you're reaching a low so fast, then you need to see how healthy you are hormonally in your mid-cycle, which is your 15, 17 days wala test. You know,
That's
that's a
good to
good
know.
test to know.
I think it's really important and so interesting for women to pay attention to their activity and their bodies on that level. And I believe you call it cycle sync training, which
Yeah,
was
we call
new.
it
I heard.
sync,
I thought that was
cycle
very
sync.
cool.
Thank you. So cycle sync training basically means this: you sync how you feel with your hormones, and do try and at least recognize if you're feeling low, how to alter your workout. Now, because I'll tell you why the cycle sync came into, I mean, it's not my invention, but it's around. It's a buzzword that's around and is making sense. You know, a lot of times women don't feel up to it. And they have they have a crazy session. Everyone's working out these days. Everybody loves to work out. But, you know, all of a
Especially
sudden you're
now,
feeling,
home workouts as well have gone up.
yeah, and you're feeling tired, and you're not up to a workout, and you've got this crazy workout plan, and you still go ahead and do it. But because you are not hormonally at rest, you have fatigue, your cortisol levels may be high because of the stress. You might finish the workout, but you're not gaining anything from that workout, because what that workout is actually going to do is it's actually going to increase your cortisol level, which is a stress response. It's going to hormonally expose you to some form of injury, you know? So it's really important to listen to your body, that there's a very fine line of making an excuse for a HIIT workout than to actually recognize that you're tired. And that fine line has to be a really good educated, well thought through decision. You know, a lot of times we'll say, oh, if you say that to someone, then they'll make excuses ki workout hi nahi karna. You know,
Yes.
that's not the point. The point is when you're feeling really low and you're saying, why am I feeling so low? Let me just, you know, let me just look what which part of my period cycle I'm on. And then you're just like, oh, maybe I'm starting my PMS and it's a good time to, you know, maybe it's a good time to slow things down.
So to quickly summarize, and I may be putting you on the spot a little bit right now, but if you could name one workout per phase you think is good,
yeah,
could you do that? Just so that our followers can literally just make a mental note.
So for your period phase, for your period phase, any movement, even it could be a walk around the house, walk around the park, just some kind of movement, 20 minutes of mat work so that you're feeling good about it. But your phase one, which is your follicular phase, which is up until your ovulation, when your hormones start rising, walking, brisk walking is a really good activity. So, you know, pace up with your walks. If you're running, you can go for your slow jogs. If you're going to the gym, don't do an HIIT session, but do a full body session, which could be a mix of body weight and weight training. But the moment you reach your ovulation phase, where your estrogen is at its peak, that is a good time to do things like boxing, high intensity interval training, Tabata workouts, even if it's a full body workout, stuff which has a lot of HIIT moves like burpees, mountain climbers, you know, that kind of humping, thumping kind of work. And again, the moment you go into your PMS phase, you might want to go back to full body workouts which are not that jumpy, walks which are brisk, because you still haven't reached your period phase. So walks, you still motivate yourself to keep them brisk. Strength training, because the moment your energy levels go down, you still have strength to pick up. Your interval training, cardiovascular strength is what starts taking a hit. And then once you reach your period, you go back to square one and that's it. So that's why I said the most important phase to really remember are your two weeks in the middle is where you pick up a new activity, where you push your trainer to up your, if you're stagnating in a workout, tell him to push up the training levels. You'll be lesser prone to injuries at that point. That's a good time to try a new high intensity workout on your week two and your week three, because your body will also give you that kind of response.
Got it. Thank you so much. This is really helpful and I feel like I've learned a lot. So I'm sure the viewers feel the same way. But thank you for joining us. And I'd love to know more about these exercises. So thank you once again.
And you guys must work out every day of your every day of the month of your period cycle. Just alter it a little bit. Now that you understand cycle thinking, hormone health is so important for a woman and they should talk freely about it.
I don't think we talk enough about it. Therefore, we don't know enough about it. So,
and PMS is not PMS is not a weak woman's disease. It is something that actually happens. You know, a lot of men say, oh, what is PMS? I mean, it's there. It's scientific. You know, hormones are all over the place. So it is something that needs to be addressed.
Thank you for saying that. We absolutely agree at NUA, obviously. But it's good to know that other people think the same way.
Thank you.
Talk to you very soon, Sumaya.
Talk to you soon. Thank you. Thank you for joining us.